eternal promise. Stirring in your sons and daughters.
Sometimes your testimony is not where God has brought you from or what he's brought you out of, but what he's protected you from, because of his protection and his grace and his favor. I now have a beautiful marriage and career and ministry and a peaceful home.
When I was 11 years old, about 10 years ago, I was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer.
Well, at an early age, I had a very, a lack of self-worth.
My family has been through many difficult times, and the example that my father set for me going through those difficult times, I would ask, why, how can you stay so calm? How can you be so cool under all this pressure? People's lives are at stake. We're about to lose our home. And
the side effects and just the symptoms were so strong. I felt so weak and just out of it every time I would wake up, every time I would come back from the hospital. And there came a point where I almost needed to go to the hospital every other day because of how strong the chemo was.
Went through school, and by the time I got to high school age, I still struggled with that. I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough. I joined the Marine Corps because I wanted to accomplish something. I wanted to prove I'm better than everybody. And spent 12 years active service, trying to be the best Marine I can be the best person.
My dad would tell me to trust in God and see that he, regardless of the circumstances, he will fulfill his promises, and he has up to this day.
I remember one night I was in my room by myself, and I had my hands raised up to the ceiling, and I was praying to God.
It took a fellow Marine coming to me and saying, "Hey, I don't know what's going on. You don't ever have to tell me. But there's only one person that can take your joy, and that's you. And that's if you let it go." And at that moment, I realized all this time I've been trying to prove a point, trying to show everybody, all my family, all my friends, that I was good enough. And in the meantime, losing my own soul, losing my joy, losing everything that God had built up to give to me.
And I just remember repeating that, "Where are you? Do something. You know, I need you. I can't go through this. I need you." And instantly, I just felt his presence from the top of my head just flow all the way through my body. And this peace and this joy just overtook me. And I started to say, "God, I know you're here, and I know you're going to be with me, and I know we're going to get through this."
I finally realized that everything that I had accomplished for myself is nothing. But God is worthy, and because of my worth in him, I'm good enough.
And from that moment on, we prayed, and we knew that God was confirming at that moment that, "Hey, you're going to go through this battle, and it's going to be tough, but I'm going to be there."
God showed me protection.
God showed me faithfulness.
God showed me that he really is our healer.
God showed me that I was good enough.
Wow. you just gotta shout, wow. Say it backwards. All right, wow. I've enjoyed this service thus far. Those children cranked it up. Wasn't that great? Justice Posis, I don't know, but you were preaching. Lord have mercy. He got all over my message. And this praise team, and I thought I heard Chet Atkins up here for a while. And a little bit later, I heard Jimi Hendrix. And all these volunteers, I am so grateful for your work and giving. I see people still coming in, and we are grateful for this. Thank you, Brother James and the teams and all of you, and so many doing so much, and I am grateful. So good to see each and every one of you here today. We're going real quick into the Word of God because I realize I am the only thing that is standing between you and an egg hunt and food trucks and water slides, bounce houses. So, one scripture, it's found in Philippians chapter 1 and verse 21. It is a real short one, and I'm going to read it. It simply says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." The greatest secret of life is found in the story of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for your goodness and your mercy. Thank you for all that you have done in our lives. Touch hearts today. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody shout amen. Amen. I started this message this past week because there's too much to preach it all today. Carville, Louisiana, on an old plantation, there was a hospital. Dr. Paul Graham was the head of it. He died in his 80s and has been gone for a while. But Carville, Louisiana became one of the last hospitals in America. In fact, it was the last one that dealt with leprosy patients. Leprosy is that which is loathsome disease that attacks your body, and the body literally decays while you are yet living. And the flesh begins to rot. Decay sets in. And Dr. Graham made the discovery that what leprosy did would attack that part of the body that responded to pain, to where the leprosy patient felt nothing. The finger could rot and fall off. The ears, he may reach up and scratch his ear and it come off in his hand. It was putrid. It was ugly. It marred and it scarred. But the patient could not feel anything. In our day and age, we want to run from pain. We don't want the hurt. We don't want that which will cause us to go through the difficult times. We don't like it. Today, I am very sore for 2 months, 8 weeks, I believe it was. I did not work out. And this past week, I started again. And God has a special place for Donnie Posis. I'll let you read between the lines whether it's a blessing or a curse. But Monday and Wednesday, it was all right. But on Friday, oh, blessed Friday. And sometime that night, I went, oh, what's wrong with me? And yesterday, and then again this morning, I go, oh. And then he comes up to me and welcomes me as I get out of my truck here at the church. I thought he's coming up to hug me. And he comes up with his hands like this, and then he brings them in, and he goes like this right into my chest. Pain! And he said, no pain, no gain. And I guess you could subtitle my message today, no pain, no gain. But we want to run from pain, but in my message today, I want to show you the blessings of pain. And in your moment of pain, in your moment of hurt, in your moment of bewilderment, in your moment of frustration, and it seems like it's all over, there is a door called hope. The children of Israel had come up out of Egypt. There had been much deliverance, miracles, and wonders that brought them to this place. The Red Sea had opened up. The plagues that had befallen the Egyptians and that got them out. And now Jericho has fallen, and victory, it seems, is theirs. But then that little small garrison of Ai rose up and smote Israel. Thousands of their battle-tested warriors fell on the plains. Joshua, their general, is bewildered. He's befuddled. He's wondering what's going on. And he questions God, shouldn't we have stayed in Egypt to come out here even with the victories that got us here? But then to have this happen? And God told him to bring the people before him, tribe by tribe. And he said, I will show you why. And all the tribes passed by, and he told them, take this tribe. He took that tribe. He said, break it down by families. And then he found Achan. And the words from General Joshua was, why have you troubled us, Achan? And Achan, standing there with his family, said, I heard what God had said. And I thought that I could take a little bit of life that God said should go to his house. And I thought I could take that wedge of gold and that little silver. And I thought I could take that raiment from the enemy's camp. And I thought I would be all right, even though I had to hide it under the rug. and the floor of my tent. See, right there, he should have been wise enough to realize how wrong it was if he had to hide it, if he had to cover it up. And God told Joshua, take this family into the valley of Achor. You can read this in Joshua chapter number 7, verse 24 through 26. He said, stone them till they die and burn them with fire, and then cover them with rocks and call this place the Valley of Achor, because Achan has troubled us this day. And so that's what they did. And now you can go there and there will be that mound of rock that covers a family that gave the valley its name, the Valley of Achor. In English, it is translated the Valley of Trouble. And once God was appeased, God opened up the rest of the land of Canaan, and they overtook, and it became what is Israel today. You said, oh, what a gruesome story. Well, just listen to me. Without the dedication, without the consecration, without the humbling of yourself before God, going through that pain, that hurt of denial, of laying yourself on the line, not my will, but thine be done. It's called repentance. It's called coming clean with God. But it always brings a door of hope. The long dark night will give way to the bright sunshine of another day. I'm preaching to somebody today. And God saw the Valley of Trouble, the Valley of Achor. And what did he do? He gave it as a type of victory for his people even to today. The writer, the prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah 65 and verse 10, as a promise to God's people, he said, and I will give you the Valley of Achor for a place where the herds will lie down. Now, I'm a country boy. I've had my cattle and have horses now. Listen to me. A place for the herd to lie down is peaceful. And God said, I'm going to give you your valley of trouble to be a place where the herds will lie down. In other words, your trouble is going to bring you peace. Your hurt is going to find its way to victory. Oh yeah, I may be sore today, but come tomorrow, I'm going to be better. And I'm going to be stronger for the hurt that came on Friday. Oh, another anointed prophet of God picked up his pen and wrote in Hosea chapter 2 and verse 15, where he said, the Valley of Achor is going to be your door of hope. Come on, Achan, you troubled Israel, and it was a black day, but it became their door of hope. Come Come on, I'm preaching to somebody. Your trouble, your problems, your frustration, your hurt, your pain, if you'll give it to Jesus, if you'll bring it to an altar, if you'll submit it to the Almighty God, it becomes your door of hope. It will swing open to your hope. Whew. Come on, somebody. This is what I'm preaching about. Your pain will become your gain. And I read from Philippians chapter 1. And it was the secret of life. And that is to live for Christ. You will find when you die, it's your gain. If you humble yourself to God, if you'll walk with Him, when you leave this earth, it's going to gain. But you hear me, you live for pleasure, and when it's over with, the pleasure is no more. And when you die, it's gone. There's nothing there. The good times, the drinking, the carousing, the partying, the living it up. Oh yeah, it's a good time. But when you die, the drugs, oh yeah, the affairs, here we go. But when it's over, when life is no more, all that ends, and God's not there. You live your life for yourself. When you die, it's all gone. When you live your life and you give it to ambition, and you strive to become all that you can be on your own, when it's over, it's empty and it's gone. When you live your life for sin, it's empty, it's gone. I remember as a young man, I had given myself to God, and I was working from 16 up into my late teens, 3 or 4 years there now, working for God and pledging my allegiance and working with children and working with youth, being responsible for over 100 people every Sunday that I would gather in for church. And that's where I thought my life was. But those last 3 years, the middle 2 years in the university, I gave myself to the calling of law. And I wanted to be an attorney. And I wanted to be what that would bring me. And that's what I sought. And that's what I was after. But at the end, I saw that it had to be what God wanted for me, not my desire. And I remember in an altar when I gave up my ambition, when I gave up my pleasure, when I gave up what I wanted, and I said, God, I'll submit to you. That's a beautiful wife I have, but hear me, I don't live my life for her. I have a son that is a Dallas police officer, but I don't live my life for him. I have a wonderful staff that makes me look good, but I don't live my life for them. This wonderful church, but I don't live my life for you. I live my life for Jesus Christ. Oh, it's Christ the solid rock I stand. And look what I've been blessed with. Look what God has blessed. I'm preaching to somebody right now. Take down the flag of your own self-importance and humble yourself to God. And watch God raise up with such victory and power and glory. Oh, friend, when you can humble yourself and walk with Him and watch Him bless you. The video that preceded this message, those young people in the hurt that was in their lives, the frustration that they were showing, the emotions that was tearing at the very fiber of their life, the hurt, the pain, the suffering. Oh, but when they laid it at the feet of a cross, they found the joy that pain could bring. Oh, somebody said, man, thank God for Friday. Oh, we call it Good Friday. But on Good Friday, that first Good Friday, there was nothing good about it at all. The cross, the suffering, the blood, the gore, Jesus suspended between heaven and earth. He who knew no sin now knows every sin that would ever be committed, past, present, and future. It was laid upon Him. Isaiah wrote and said that He would be marred to where nobody would even recognize Him. Beaten, slapped, ridiculed, and then fastened to that tree with nails. Watch this, though. When He hung His head and died, and they laid Him in the tomb, but on that great getting up morning, the stone rolls away of its own accord, as if nature was saying, there's no way I can hold back God Almighty. And on the third day, like He had promised, He said, on the third day, I'll raise Him up again. He come out of that grave triumphant over death, hell, and the grave. And He said, I have a life, and that life is more abundant. And He said, because I live, ye shall live. Come on, somebody. Why do we call it Good Friday? When that Friday was nasty. When that Friday was ugly. When that Friday was nothing but pain and suffering. Let me tell you why. Because we have the perspective from the 2 days later when He rose again. But if you're on the other side, it's all ugly. It's all painful. It's all nasty. But when you're on this side, when you're on the resurrection morning side, when you're on the, oh, hear me now, that's when you say, hey, that was a good day. That was a good day. He took my place. He brought my salvation. He set me free. He purchased my life. Come on, somebody. That's what I'm talking about. Oh, that's why today I can say Friday was a bad day. But now, 2 days later, I'm feeling better. I'm alive. I'm preaching to somebody now. If you have the perspective of this side where it's all ugly, it's all, then bring it to Jesus. Just like those young people in the video. lost, bewildered, unworthy, no good, chemo and cancer, losing everything, family this, and everything turned and twisted, and it was nothing but pain. The very beginning, it was all pain, it was all hurt, it was all catastrophe, it was all bad news. Ha ha, but come on now. You heard Justice Posis this morning when he was talking to us about it's all Jesus Christ. Why? Because he's already done what he said he would do. And that is, he'll take your place. So whether you find yourself with sickness, with heartache, heartbroken, whether you feel like it's empty, and that's what scares me about some of y'all in here today, you don't feel anything now. You don't feel God. You don't feel, you know, your sin. It's all right. I'm okay. You don't feel it. Because that's what sin does. Sin is always likened to leprosy in the Bible. And when you get to that point to where you can't feel, friend, that's when you'll start missing things. Pieces of your life just start falling back and falling away. And it's all right. You get used to it and you just go through the motions. But I'm here today to tell you, that kind of living, when it's dead, when it's over, there's nothing there. And when a religious leader this week in our world would rise up and say there is no hell, you ought to be scared to death, because the enemy of your soul is trying to sell you a bill of goods that you're okay and you don't have to worry about it. Nothing. You just do what you want to do, live. But you better get in this Word of God. And you better hide the Word of God in your heart, that you will not sin against God. How? When you repent of your sins, when you're baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Bible says you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Oh, yeah. That's what happened to those of the first church. Yeah, that's what happened to them. They denied him. They even stepped out and said, I don't know the man. I'm not one of his. And they all run from him. And to where he was all alone hanging on the tree. His mother was there and his best friend, and he sent them away together. And there he hung his head and died. But friend, it wasn't long after that, in an upper room experience where they all gathered together and they did what he told them to. He said, go and tarry, and you shall be endued with power from on high. That was that repentance. They went through the pain. They laid it down. But friend, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there appeared unto them cloven tongues as of fire, and sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. What I'm preaching to us today is, friend, change your perspective. If you're hurting, bring it to Jesus. Humble yourself before him. Lay it on that altar. And then, when you're filled with that blessed Holy Ghost, you will be on the other side of the resurrection. And you will see how good it was for him to take your place. As our heads are bowed and the eyes are closed, God, you're looking down upon us. You're in this room right now. You see men and women and young people who have come. They wept on a bed last night. Maybe it was affliction. Maybe it was pain and sickness and death. Maybe it was because of what they had done, or maybe even what they hadn't done. But it brought to them that hurt, that loneliness. And Lord, I pray today that as we bow our heads in this meeting, and we'll all humble ourselves to God, we'll submit ourselves to Jesus Christ, and Lord, we'll repent, and you will bring us great glory and power in the Holy Ghost. You will give us for our valley of trouble a door of hope from which we will be saved. Bless, I pray. As our heads are bowed and the eyes are closed, men and women are standing here at the front. There are prayer teams, and they're ready to pray with you. As our heads are bowed, you're in this place today, and no one's looking around, and you're saying, but preacher, yes, I need help. Oh, I'm in trouble. I'm in pain. Whatever it is, mentally, emotionally, physically, spiritually, financially, socially, just slip your hand up and say, preacher, I need help. Way in the back, I see hands. Here at the front, I see hands. All over this house, hands are... Would you be honest? If you were to die today, are you ready to meet Jesus? If you were to die today, would you're living for pleasure? You're living for self. You're living for your own ambition. You're living in sin. What would it do for you? Where would it leave you? I'm praying right now. Would you get up from where you are and come to Jesus? Many have already started coming. But would you come? Come on. I've already met some of you today. The hurt was so evident in your life. Some of you even opened up and told me. You said, I'm here. Come on, young people. Come on, mom and dad. Come on, grandparents, singles. Whatever your hurt, bring it to Jesus. I see 4 or 5 first-time people here in this altar. Hallelujah. Others have come. You say, but I've come many times. That's all right. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. It doesn't mean you're going to join this church. It doesn't mean you're going to take out membership in this church. No, it just means I got to bring myself to Jesus. I'm going to humble myself to Jesus Christ. I wish our deacons would come join us here. We're being overwhelmed by people in this altar. Deacons and elders, would you join us here? Ministers, would you come? Hallelujah. Raise your hand to heaven right now. I want that door of hope, preacher. I want that door of hope, preacher. I need help over here to my left. Hallelujah. I need more helpers over here to my left, please. Hallelujah. 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 Right there where you are, why don't you make your right with God? Submit yourself to God. Humble yourself. I need you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He loves you. He knows right where you are. Would we all stand together? Let's stand here in the auditorium. Raise your hands to heaven.
Come and make your throne upon our praise.
Say, but I don't feel anything. You better be asking God, let me feel it. Let me feel your hand, God. Let me feel your voice. Come on. Oh, yes. Your door of trouble is a door of hope. That valley of trouble becomes a door of hope. That's it, sir. Look at this couple. It's a mother and a daughter. Oh, yes. Some singles. Come on, your prison house. The doors will be open wide. and you'll come out of it. Your valley of trouble becomes your door of hope. Come on.